called love. It's all about God's love, all about how we want to love one another in the same way that God loves us. And this morning, what I want us to do is to look at John chapter 11. Because I believe that the main point of John's gospel is all about God's love for us. John chapter 11, 1 through 5 says these words. And Felicia read these to you earlier. It says, "Now a certain man named Lazarus was ill. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and his sister Martha. This was the same Mary who anointed the Lord with fragrant oil and wiped his feet with her hair. And her brother Lazarus was ill." It goes on to say in verse 3, "So the sisters sent word to Jesus saying, 'Lord, the one whom you love is ill.' And when he heard this, Jesus had this reply, 'This illness isn't fatal. It's for the glory of God, so that God's Son can be glorified through it.' And it says that Jesus loved Martha and her sister Mary, as well as Lazarus." So we're going to stop in the story today, and we're going to pick it up again next week. But I want us to focus on this part. And I want us to focus specifically on the words, "the one you love." This morning we're going to talk about that idea. What does it mean to be the one you love? So turn to the person next to you and say, "You are the one that he loves." Even if you don't believe it, just say it. I heard you. You are the one that he loves. Can you feel the love in the room? Can you feel that? We are loved people, right? We are God's loved people. We love one another in this room today, and we know that God loves us. But let's be honest for just a second. It can be difficult when things get challenging to be loving. And it can be difficult when things intensify and when life situations escalate. And what ends up happening is we don't speak in quite as loving a way. Nobody looked at the person next to them and said, "You are the one that he loves." Right? Everybody smiled. Everybody was happy, right? But sometimes when life presses in on us, when life becomes so tough, we don't say that. What we end up doing is saying those things that usually were really good because we keep them up here and they're locked away and we think them, but they don't come out of our mouth. But when life gets really tough, that non-loving stuff comes out. The stuff that is boiling underneath comes to the surface. In fact, in that same train of thought, it takes us right back to Mary and Martha and their situation in these five short verses we just read, because they're in the thick of it. They're in the craziness of life's situations and the places when life gets messy. Their brother, their little brother who they love, is on death's doorstep, and he's hours away from passing in to eternity. You see, it becomes clear to me in this scripture, they have tried every other avenue to save their little brother. They've had the local doctor come out. They've done everything that they know to do, and it hasn't worked. He's still declining. He's still heading towards death. He's still at death's doorstep, and they've concluded there's only one last avenue to try. They said, "We need a miracle. The only way to save our brother is through God's miracle, and we only know one miracle worker. That's God himself." So they come up with a plan. They say, "We need Jesus to heal Lazarus." They needed Jesus to save their brother's life. So they come up with a very simple, logical, four-step plan. Step one, we're going to write him a note. We know he's just a few miles away preaching, so we're going to write him a note. We're going to put it in a runner's hand. We're going to have that runner run those miles to Jesus and put that note in his hand. When Jesus reads that note and sees the contents of it, it will compel him to come down the road and to save our brother's life. Pretty simple plan, right? Made a lot of sense. Write a note, get it in his hands, and he'll come. In this process, we discover a lot about Mary and Martha. And the number one thing we discover is what they believe about God. And what I found myself in the journey I've walked over the last month and a half is I found a lot about what I believe about God. And I drove home from the hospital yesterday morning to go see my son compete in the reading bowl. And to know I was going to have to look at him, and at some point that day I was going to have to tell him his papa was gone. I had to think in my own soul, what do I believe about God? Because life was real in that moment. The conversation was going to have to happen. I was going to have to sit on my couch with my wife and my kids and say, your granddad's gone. And I had to ask myself, what do I believe about God? When push comes to shove, when it's a matter of life and death, when the heat is on, what Mary and Martha really have to do is they have to ask, what do we believe about Jesus? Now keep in mind, Mary and Martha and Lazarus were some of the closest friends that Jesus had beside his own literal family. The second to last week of his life and his ministry on earth was spent exclusively in the presence of Mary and Martha and Lazarus. These were close friends of Jesus. Lazarus was one of his buddies. He was one of his guys. This was one of his sidekicks. This wasn't his team. You know, he had his disciples. He had his followers. Lazarus was something different. He was a buddy. He was the guy that he could go to and say, I'm thinking about dropping this bomb on the disciples about this bread and this wine and my body. What do you think, man? You think they're going to take this? You know, he was close. He was part of Jesus' heart. Listen to the context of the note that they write. You know, first of all, what is shocking to me is the length of this note. I mean, how short is the note going to be? If you have one note to save a loved one's life, it ain't going to be that short. It's going to have some detail. You know, if you had one note to write to save your mother-in-law's life, hey, God, I know you're busy. Just do your best. No, I'm just kidding. Be nice to mother-in-law. But if you had one note to write to save a loved one's life, one note to write to save your brother's life, you know, if I was writing a note to God to save my brother's life, I would go into his spiritual resume. I would give God great detail. I would start with his spiritual statistics. His average time spent in prayer each day. Hello, God. I know this is a life and death situation. My brother Tom, he's a really good guy. You know Tom, he's a preacher. I know he's Baptist, but come on, he's giving it a try. God, Tom loves you. Come on, God, you know that he loves you. Tom is all about you, God. Don't you want to save Tom's life because of everything that he does to show you how much he loves you? But listen to what they write. Lord, the one you love is sick, period. That's a note. I remember reading that the first time and going, what? But this is what Mary and Martha believe about God. This is what they understand about Jesus, and this is huge for us today. They believe that what will move God the most is his love for Lazarus, not Lazarus' love for him. You need to get that this morning. That's important. What moves God is his love for Lazarus, not Lazarus' love for him. And that kind of shocked me personally, because I'll tell you right now, this is not about a sermon or a sermon series. As much for me as this is about a personal journey for me. Because I start to read this and I start to think about this and I start to investigate my personal relationship with God. And it starts to alarm me and I start to think, what is the real focus of the gospel? You know, on the surface, yes, it's the good news of what God has done through Jesus. But what's the focus and the heart of this gospel? Is it us loving God? Or is it God loving us? Because it's really important. You know, I come to the obvious biblical conclusion that the essence of the gospel is the overwhelming message of God's love for us, not our love for God. Here's a thought that could actually change your entire outlook on your relationship with God and the way you live your life. Think about what moves God the most. Who moves God the most? God. God moves God the most. You know, it dawned on me, you know, John 3:16. It dawned on me as I think about John 3:16. It's like our Christian motto. You know, the Super Bowl today, rainbow hair guy is going to have his John 3:16 sign, right? Everybody knows John 3:16. You learn it when you're a kid. Even if you're far from the church, never even been in a church, you probably heard John 3:16. And we read it just like this. For the world so loved God that he gave his only forgotten son. Maybe we don't literally read it that way, but we live it that way. But that's not what it means. See, we think about our lives and we think, you know, God, I've been living my life as if the gospel story went something like this. God's in heaven, God's pacing his streets of gold, and on this dusty little place we call earth, there's a remnant of people who are imploring God because of our passion for him, because of our desire and our love, and the way that we intrigue God. So that God is so enraptured with us, and God hears our love and our praise for him, that he says, I'm going to come to you and I'm going to love you. You see, so God's pacing up and down his streets of gold. He's considering our offer. He's wondering, should I come or should I not? I have a lot to do up here, but boy, those people on earth are convincing. So God says, they sure want me to do it. They sure want me to come down there, so I guess I will go down there. They're singing songs in church. They're putting money in the offering plate. I guess I should show up because they love me so much. The fact of the matter is that's not what the gospel says at all. It says, for God so loved the world. So loved the world. Look at that word, so. In front of love. He didn't just love the world, he so loved the world. That's a little bit different. So let's insert the word obsession instead of just love. Because if you so love something, you are obsessed with it. See, I think that's fair to say. I think it's fair to say God was so obsessed with the world. Have you ever considered how ridiculous and illogical our most famous verse in all of Christianity is? For God so loved the world. For God was so obsessed with what? The what? The world? What is the world? The world is bad, broken, sinful, failed creation, failed perfection. For God was obsessed with brokenness and sin and badness and people that fall short. So John 3:16 reads like this. God was so obsessed with the bad people that he put on skin and bone and came to the earth and died for who? For us. For whoever. For whomever. He came and died for everyone. We're going to live our lives as a whoever. I mean, think about this. If I give you a car, you come into church on Sunday, I give you the keys and say, it's a brand new car, I bought it for you. Next time I see you on the road, you better be driving that car, right? I expect to see you driving in that car. See, I give it to you with an expectation that you're going to appreciate it. Right? That's how the world works. We give someone a gift, and we expect to see them wearing it, experiencing it, using it, loving it. And if they don't, we feel like, well, maybe the gift wasn't nice enough. Or maybe they didn't appreciate the gift. But what the gospel is all about is to say that God is so obsessed with us, even in our brokenness, that He gave His Son on the premise that whoever, wherever, however, whenever, would receive His love. So what kind of love is this? Because it's not familiar to me. This kind of love is not familiar to us in an earthly context. Because God is obsessed with bad people. This isn't really a good deal for God. I mean, if we're being honest, this isn't a good deal for God. I mean, have you ever heard the term groupie? You know, groupie for the Rolling Stones, groupie for One Direction, groupie for Justin Bieber. Well, that's just Bob. You know, groupie, but a groupie is someone that's so obsessed with someone that will never reciprocate that love to them. And it gets kind of weird. You got a 20-year-old that sells everything they got, they buy a van, and they follow around a van that doesn't even know they exist. That's what a groupie is. You know, somebody came to me, I guess it was probably about a month ago, and said, you know, this gospel of God doesn't really make sense. You know, why would a God be a groupie for a person? Why would God give everything and follow around me as a 29-year-old flunky who screws everything up in life? And I just kind of looked at him and said, welcome to the party. So God doesn't make sense. I'm sorry, but God's not really supposed to make sense. God's not a vending machine or a math equation that you push the right buttons and you get what you want. If that was the case, then who would God be, right? God's a mystery. That's kind of what makes Him God. If you understand God, then that's probably not really God. God's ways are higher than our ways. His love is deeper than our love. He loves us in our failure. He's obsessed with us even in our brokenness. Even bad people who stay bad, God stays in love with them. But what is love without a choice? You know, we can preach universal salvation. We can say, look, you just go out there and you screw up all you want. You do whatever you want. And God's just going to eventually, you know, the day you die, He's going to just take you on up to heaven anyway. But what's love without a choice? Without choice, we've lost the definition of love. You see, in our culture and in our society, love without choice gets you in jail. Because love without you having a choice to receive that love or not is abuse. I don't really want to serve a God who loves me without a choice, who doesn't give me a choice in the matter. Because you see, God is not abusive. God gives us a choice. We can either acknowledge His obsession towards us, or we can ignore it. It's our choice, but the obsession remains. God continues to love us. 1 John 4:10 says, this is love. It is not that we loved God, but that He loved us and sent His Son as a sacrifice that dealt with our sins. You see, before it tells us what love is, it tells us what love is not. This is love. Not that you loved God, because you didn't. But God loved you. God's first. God is the initiator of love. This is about God. I realize, man, I've been so busy in my life obsessing with getting things right that I've gotten things out of order. I wondered, have I missed the whole focus of it? Have I missed God's obsession with me? Because I've been so focused on my performance. I've been so focused on my deeds and my efforts. You see, Mary and Martha made it abundantly clear when they used the word love in their note. Lord, the one you love is ill. The word love that they used there is the word that most of us use when we refer to love. It's what we sang about this morning when we sang about love. It's a word, philia, P-H-I-L-E-O. Those of you who are not familiar with the origin language, philia is the word that is really used in the original script here of Mary and Martha. It means earthly love. It's the love that we talk about when we get married, when two people make a choice to love one another. It's the word we talk about when we talk about loving a best friend, our BFF, our bae. We love them. Philia is a love that's based upon reciprocation, right? We got a church full of engaged couples. I don't know what happened. They all just wanted to be like Austin. They all got engaged. We got people working in the kids' ministry that engaged today. We got people sitting here engaged. They're all engaged, but they all got engaged because one person said, "You want to do life with me?" And the other person said, "Yeah, I do." And they said, "I love you, you love me," check yes or no. They check yes, and now they're getting married. But it's based upon reciprocation. Both people have to agree. Both people have to agree to love one another. Mary and Martha write this note to Jesus, and they say to him, "The one that you love and loves you back is sick." They say, "God, this is your boy. This is Lazarus. He loves you, man. And he needs you because you love him. Y'all are tight. Y'all love each other, and he's sick." See, Mary and Martha think this is filial love. You think that God loves you with filial love. But I'm here to tell you, God does not love us with filial love. He doesn't. He never has loved us in this way. He never will love us this way. God has a love that's exclusively His. It flows from His being. It's the essence of who He is, and it's not filial earthly love. It's an otherworldly love. It's really the essence of God. God does not feel love. God does not express love. God is love. And God always acts in consistency with the contents of His character. God is love. God is not filial love based on reciprocation. God is agape love. What is agape love? Agape is a love that absolutely does not need any reciprocation whatsoever. It's unconditional. It's relentless. It's persistent. And it's aggressive. And it's God's love for you and me. It doesn't take no for an answer. It remains through all circumstance. It is the nature of who God is. It's how God functions. He has agape love for every human being that has ever lived. God does not filial love humanity. God agapes humanity. We've got a message to share. It's not that you're bad. It's not that God's obsessed with you. He can't help himself. You can't shake him. The message that we have to share is that you can't run, you can't hide. God's love is available for you, and it will remain no matter what. I pray today that as we prepare to go from this place today, as we get in our cars and as we live this next week of our lives, I pray that our minds are preoccupied with the thoughts of what it would be like not to have this kind of love. I pray that we don't worry about our performance, that we don't worry about our success, that we don't worry about our weakness. I pray that we are preoccupied with God's extraordinary, extensive, and expansive love for us. A love that never fails. A love that never quits. A love that has existed since the beginning of a time. A love that remains for all time. An extraordinary love that we have an awesome invitation to say yes to. Let's pray together. Jesus, we're overwhelmed. We don't have the words to express our gratitude or our appreciation for your love. Your love changes every aspect of our life and our being. I pray today that you would transform and change our lives by your love. I pray today that you would help us to respond and accept and acknowledge and to live out your love towards us. I thank you for that, Lord. I thank you for your agape love in the form of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. This morning, as we prepare to respond to God, you know, I think that I'm not the only one that grew up seeing faith like this. Faith was something that was deeply rooted in fear. I worried that I'd done too many things wrong and that God couldn't love me. I worried that I hadn't checked enough boxes of doing enough good things for God to love me. I worried I could never perform good enough to get Him to love me and to accept me. I worried that I just wasn't good enough for the kind of love that God had. But I've realized in my life that there's nothing that I could ever do to earn His love. I realized that God simply loves me because I am His. I realize that God is obsessed with me even on the days that I don't return or reciprocate His affection. And I realize as your pastor that He loves each and every one of you in that same way. Exactly as you are. Exactly as broken as you may be today. Maybe you're carrying anger. Maybe you're full of fear. Maybe you're dealing with grief. No matter who you are, no matter what you've done, God loves you. It's exactly why we're here today, and we know that. So what's a reasonable response to a love that we can't even fathom? I think it's a very simple response. God, I know you love me, and my only reasonable response is to give you my life. It's to say, God, it's broken, it's screwed up, it's flawed, it's full of blemishes and bruises and scars. But you can have it, God. You can use it. I trust in your grace. I trust in your Son. I accept your love and sacrifice. God, count me in. I surrender my life. I invite you to take out your connection card this morning and flip it over to the back side. That may be a first-time thing for you. To say, God, I want to acknowledge your love and I want to live my life in a way that acknowledges it. Or maybe that's something you need to do as a renewal thing. Maybe it's to say, you know what, I'm going to love God and I'm going to do it in a community of faith that can support me through that. I'm going to do it surrounded by a body of other people that are seeking to love God. So maybe today it's to say, I want to see what it means to live a life fully surrendered to Jesus Christ. Or maybe it's to say, I want to inquire more about joining this church and being a part of this church family. Or maybe it's simply to say, I'll give you this one series, God. I'll show back up next week. I'll give you the month of February. I'll listen a little more about your love. I'm not ready yet to give you everything, but I'll give you a month. Let's take a second. Respond to God on our connection cards. If you'd like to, you can come and pray here at the altar or simply respond there at your seat.